Now we are on to chapter 10, coding and testing of Dr. Rajiv Mall's book on software engineering. The first is distinguish between error and failure, and testing detects which of these two and justify your answer. So we have learned about error and failure in the theory section. So the failure is the manifestation of an error or said defect or a bug. So failure is the result of an error, and the testing it will detect the failure. What happens that the exact cause of failure, that is the error, has to be determined through debugging, because error may be there, error may be present there, but it may not cause or it may not be resulting in a failure. But error will always have a possibility of creating a failure. Second is what are driver and stub modules in the context of integration and unit testing of a software product, and why are these stub and driver modules, they are required actually. So these modules, they are required to provide a necessary environment. You know, one will call another, one will be called, so either call or be called by some module under test. They are usually not available until the two have been unit tested. So we have these stubs and drivers. They are designed to provide a complete environment for a module. You want to test a module, we don't have those modules which are ready. For that we create stubs and the drivers. And the stub procedure is a dummy procedure that has the same input-output parameter as a given procedure, but a very simplified behavior, because input-output and the answer, the inputs in the form of parameters and output in the form of return. For an instance, a stub procedure may produce the expected behavior using a simple table lookup mechanism only. You can have a table, you don't have to make exact module or a function like that. It will just take value from some table. But a driver module would contain the non-local data structures, which is accessed by the module under test, and would also have the code to call the different functions of the module with the appropriate parameter values. So what happens if this module is there and it is, you know, calling or giving rise to these modules which are not ready? So we make the stubs here. Or if this is being called by any module, upper level module, then we create a driver for this module. So we are testing this module. For that we require the called one to be a driver, and the calling one to be driver, and the called one to be stubs. We have to state true and false and reason with proper reasoning. The effectiveness of a test suite in detecting errors in a system can be determined by counting the number of test cases in the suite. Well, this is very intuitive. The answer would be false, because the test cases detect the same errors if we design so many test cases or create so many test cases, and they are detecting the same errors, then the simple count would be rather misleading as far as test cases are concerned. B. Once the Maccabe cyclomatic complexity of a program has been determined, it is very easy to identify all the linearly independent paths of the program. And this is false. You know why? This is false because if just by computing the cyclomatic complexity of a program, it would not be very easy to identify all the linearly independent paths of the program. You know, there may be other possibilities also. C is, use of static and dynamic program analysis tools is an effective substitute for thorough testing. Well, this answer is somewhat near to false, but in today's scenario, static and dynamic program analysis tools are such that they are actually testing the program or your software thoroughly. But this is misleading, that use of static and dynamic program analysis tools is an effective substitute. The thorough testing for those projects which can, a simple problem or error may create a catastrophe, for that thorough testing is required. D. During code review, you detect errors, whereas during code testing, you detect failures. Code review, errors, code testing, you detect failures. And this is absolutely correct or true, because during code review, The errors are that the errors can be directly spotted on the code. Whereas during this course testing, we find out the problems of this error, or we detect the problems of this or the consequences of these errors, which are the manifestation of error, which are the failures. And then we debug, because it becomes necessary if we identify the errors. E is a pure top-down integration testing does not require the use of any stub modules. And this is again false, because even if you apply top-down, you require stubs. You apply bottom-up, you will require drivers. So a pure top-down integration testing does not require the use of any driver modules. It's actually not required at all. So adherence to coding standards is checked during the system testing stage. Adherence to coding standards. Now this is false, because adherence to coding standards like MISRA C, MISRA C++, and JSF, etc. is checked before unit testing through code inspections. There is static tools which are available, which check for these coding standards without even running the program. G. A program can have more than one linearly independent path. Yeah, this is of course true. A program can have more than one linearly independent path, because the upper bound on the number of linearly independent path of a program is the cyclomatic complexity for the program. This is the upper bound. The question H, or true false H, that is the number of test cases required for branch coverage based testing of a program can be greater than those required for path coverage based testing of the same program. And this is false, because the number of test cases required for path coverage testing of a program, this can be greater than those required for branch coverage based testing of the same program. I. Branch coverage based testing is a stronger testing strategy compared to path coverage based testing. And this is false, because we have seen in the discussion also that the path coverage based testing, this can detect errors that are not detected by the branch coverage based testing. Path coverage based testing detects more error. J. Out of all types of internal documentation that is provided in the source code, careful commenting is the most useful, right? The answer is false, because our internal documentation is which is done inside the, which is inside your code. So out of all the type of internal documentation which is in the source code, the meaningful variable names are the most useful. Then K, error and failures are synonymous in software testing terminology. We have talked about error and failure a lot, and we know that failure is nothing but the manifestation of an error or a defect or a bug. So these two are not similar. Next one, development of suitable driver and stub functions are essential for carrying out effective system testing of a product. And this is false, because now we are talking about system testing. System testing is only carried out when the system is fully integrated. So no driver or stub modules are actually necessary here during system test processing. M. System testing can be considered as a white box testing. This is again false, because system test cases, they test the functionality of the system as you have written in SRS document. So they are pure black box tests. System testing is pure black box testing. N. The main purpose of integration testing is to find design errors. No. The main purpose of integration testing is to find the interface errors among modules. Once you test the modules, unit tests you have performed, now you want to check the interfacing between the modules. For that, you do integration testing. O. Introduction of additional edges and nodes in this CFG, that is control flow graph, due to introduction of sequence type of statements in the program, can increase the cyclomatic complexity of the program. Is it true? No, it is false, because if you introduce additional edges and nodes in this control flow graph due to introduction of a sequence type of statement in the program, it has no effect on the cyclomatic complexity of the program. Next one, the terms software verification and software validation are synonyms. No, verification and validation, they are entirely different terms. Verification is whether you are making the product right. Validation is whether you are making the right product. Okay, so software verification concerns checking whether the output of one phase conforms to the preceding phase. While the validation checks that the fully functional system, it conforms to the SIS, that is the specification which are provided by the user. Then the main purpose of integration testing is to find design errors. No, again we have seen this is wrong. Integration testing is used to find the interfacing errors between the modules. Code walkthrough for a module is normally carried out after unit testing is over. This is false because code walkthrough is carried out just before unit testing. Before you can even start unit testing, you perform the code walkthrough. Then code walkthrough for a module is normally carried out after the module successfully compiles, and this is true. S. During code walkthrough, most of the system syntax errors are identified. This is false. Why? Because even your compiler, you know, those IDEs which are using right now, like Visual Studios and all those Java stuffs, they can easily catch the syntax error. So code walkthrough is carried out only after the code successfully compiles. It has to remove the syntax error, then only code walkthrough can begin. What is the difference between black box testing and white box testing? Means the functional testing and the structural testing. In black box testing, the test cases are designed for an examination of input-output values only, and no knowledge of the design or the internal structure or code is required. And in this white box testing, the test cases are designed which in turn require you to have a thorough knowledge about the internal structure of the software. Next is, what is the difference between internal and external documentation? What are the different ways of providing internal documentation? Out of these, which is most useful? Internal documentation, which is inside your code. This is the code comprehension features provided as part of the source code itself, like comments, etc. So all other type of documents, they are called external documents. This internal document is also provided through the use of, say, meaningful variable names, the module, the function headers, the code indentation like right braces, code structuring, use of enumerated types, constant identifier, use of user-defined data types, etc. Sixth, what is meant by structural complexity of a program? Structural complexity of a program. Define a metric for measuring the structural complexity of a program. How is structural complexity of a program different from the computational complexity? The structural complexity of a program defines an upper bound on the number of independent paths in a program. So we are interested in finding out the independent paths in a program. So if we are given a control flow graph, or we can make control flow graph of a program, the structural complexity can be easily computed by the number of edges minus the number of nodes plus 2, where n is the number of nodes and in the control graph e is the number of edges. Then write a C function for searching an integer value from a large sorted sequence of integer values stored in an array of 100 using the binary search method. You can build the control flow graph, design a test suite, and how is subcurrency complexity used in designing test suite for path coverage. Now this is a question which is already being answered in the theory session, so I'll leave this as an exercise for you. 8. Give a software product and its requirement specification document or SRS. Explain how would you design the systems test suite or suites for the software product. The functional test suite can be designed by examining the input and output domains of the functional requirement simply. So the performance test suite can be designed by examining the non-functional requirement. Okay. Functional requirement, functional test suite, non-functional requirement, performance test suite. What is coding standard? Identify the problem that might occur if the engineers of an organization do not adhere to any coding standard. Nowadays, coding standard has become a vital ingredient of any SDLC. The coding standard, it lists several rules that needs to be followed during coding, such as how to name a variable, how the code should be laid out, and what will be the error return conventions, whether it should be plus one, minus one, like this, in which case it should come. If no coding standard is adopted or used or employed, the codes may be difficult to understand and of course may not be efficient, as code written using some well-defined coding standards are more efficient. Now we have a question, what is the difference between a coding standard and a coding guideline? There's a difference. What are these considered important? Why are these considered important in a software development organization? And write down 5 important coding standards and coding guidelines that you would recommend. So first of all, we'll see these coding standards. They are followed compulsorily now. While these coding guidelines, they are just a general suggestion according to the coding style to be followed, but leave the actual implementation of these guidelines to the discretion of individual engineers only. They can adopt their own style, but there are certain guidelines. But coding standards, they need to be followed compulsorily. Coding standards, these are the rules for limiting the use of global variables, the content of the header preceding code for different modules, what it should be, and naming convention for the global variable, local variable, and constant identifiers, and error return conventions and the exceptional or any exception or problem handling mechanism. These are given in coding standards. While in coding guidelines, they do not use a coding style. That is, it says that do not use a very complex or clever or too difficult to understand coding style. Any obscure side effect needs to be avoided. And coding guidelines say that do not use an identifier for multiple purposes. You cannot say that I'm saving the space. The code should be well documented. And the length of any function should not exceed 10 source line. And do not use go-to statements. These are coding guidelines. Then we have when during the development process, is the compliance with the coding standard is checked? When? And list two coding standard, each for enhancing readability of the code and reuse of the code. First is the compliance with coding standards is checked after the coding for a module is complete and the module is successfully compiled. The coding standards for enhancing readability would be like this. The contents of the header preceding code for different modules, the naming conventions for global variables, local variables, and constant identifiers, and coding standard for enhancing reuse, the rule for using limiting the use of globals, and the error return conventions, also the exception handling mechanism like try and catch, etc. The 12th is distinguish between software verification and software validation. And when during the software lifecycle are verification and validation performed? Can one be used in place of other? And as I suggested, verification is whether you are making a right product, and software validation is whether you are making the product right, and software validation is whether you are making the right product. So we mean by software validation that you are making the right product. That means it should conform to the SRS. While verification means that the output of the one phase should conform to the next phase. So verification means that if you are adding two values, then it should add. But user may have given you to multiply the values. So software verification only checks that addition is correct or not. So software verification, it checks whether the output of one phase conforms to the preceding phase. Output of one phase conforms to the preceding phase. So it is a phase-wise affair. While the software validation, it checks whether the fully functional system conforms to the specification. So verification is performed at the end of every phase, while validation is performed after a fully integrated and working product is ready. Then only we can check that whether the functional or non-functional properties are met. Which one of the following is the strongest structure testing technique? Statement coverage based testing, branch coverage testing, a condition based coverage testing. Justify your answer. The answer is the condition coverage is the strongest structure test technique. Prove the branch coverage testing is stronger than the statement coverage testing. In this question, the answer will come here. So it can be proved by proving that the branch coverage, it ensures the statement coverage. All statements are being covered. But branch coverage, this can detect some errors that cannot be detected using the statement coverage. Okay, it ensures statement coverage, but also it can detect errors that cannot be detected using the statement coverage bias. So the first part can be proved, this one, by noting that each statement of a program belongs to some branch. It will always be in some branch. So when a branch coverage is achieved, the statement will be automatically covered. All statement will be automatically visited. And the second part would be that it can be proved by the fact that statement coverage cannot detect errors in a program containing a loop, which manifests only when the loop condition is false. Okay. Then which is the stronger testing, data flow testing or path testing? Give the reason behind your answer. You can answer this. Can you answer this? That which is the stronger testing, data flow testing or path testing? So of course the answer would be. So these are the two testing strategy of your white box. So in data flow testing, what happens that the state or any event that happens, the test cases are designed like that. It will not cover the input output points, while the path testing, it covers that also. But data flow testing is the you can have less test cases and you can generate more test on this. So it's up to you which you decide. So I hope that this answers. 16. Briefly highlight the difference between code inspection and code walkthrough. Compare the relative merit of code inspection and code walkthrough. So in contrast to code walkthrough, the aim of code inspection is to discover some common type of errors which are caused by some oversight or improper programming. So code inspection is finding errors, while during code inspection, the code is examined for the presence of certain kind of errors. In code walkthroughs, hand simulation of code execution is done. Okay, in code walkthrough, a hand simulation of code execution is actually done, not the system execution, but the hand simulation. What is meant by code walkthrough? What are some of the important types of errors checked through the code walkthroughs? I hope this question will answer this also. In code walkthrough, each member of a review team, it selects some test cases and simulate execution of the code by hand. That is, traces execution through each statement and function execution. The main objective of code walkthrough is to discover the algorithm and logical error. While in this code inspection, we try to examine the code in order to find some kind of various different kind of errors. But when the people are handling things with work on paper, then the algorithmic or logic errors may surface out. Answer these. Suppose a branch contain n decision points, each of which has two branches. How many test cases are necessary for branch testing? So the answer for this A is 2n, 2 to the power n cases. Then second is, if there are n choices at each decision point, how many test cases are needed for branch testing? For n, we have m choices, so that will be m into n test cases. Second is it possible to achieve branch coverage using smaller number of test cases? Then you have answer depending on the branch condition. Justify answer. Yes, if some branches cannot assume certain logic values, then it is possible to achieve branch coverage using the smaller number of test cases also. C is, for a program containing n binary branches, how many test cases are necessary for path coverage? For a program, first we'll answer the study the second part also. For a program containing n numbers of m array branches, how many test cases are necessary for path coverage? So we have n plus 1 test cases. They are needed for the path coverage, as the cyclomatic complexity is n plus 1 because n binary branches are there. And for m array branches, that will be n into n. This is how we do it. Then the question is, how many test cases are necessary for path testing in each case? Justify your answer, and this will be given by your cyclomatic complexity only. Then we have question, usually large software products are tested at three different testing levels, unit testing, integration and system testing. Why do not do single thorough testing of the system after the system is developed? That is, detect all the defects of the product during system testing. Now, if there is only one level of testing, then there would be too many places to look for an error and debugging effort would be very high. And unit testing, integration testing and system testing, they all offer different kind of errors. Okay, so all these errors cannot be easily found out in a thorough testing. For that, you have to go to these different level of testing. And what do you understand by the term system testing, and what are the different kinds of system testing that are usually performed on a large software products? So system tests are designed to validate a fully developed system to assure that it meets its requirement, that is, it conforms to the SRS requirements. And there are essentially three main kind of system testing. First is alpha testing, beta testing, and acceptance testing. In alpha testing, it refers to the system testing carried out by the testing within the developer organization itself, which is developing. Beta testing is performed by some group of friendly customers, may be at their places. Acceptance testing is the system testing performed by the customer itself to determine whether he should accept the delivery of the system or not. Question 21 is, usability of software product is tested during which type of testing? Unit, integration, or system testing? And how is usability tested? Usability. Usability of a product is tested during the system testing level of testing. So during usability testing, the display screen and messages, report formats, and other aspects relating to the user interface requirements are tested. 22. Now suppose a developed software has successfully passed all the three levels of testing. That is unit testing, integration testing, and system testing. Can we claim that the software is defect-free? And justify your answer. The answer is no, actually. We cannot, anytime we cannot claim that the software is defect-free. Because these three levels of testing do not do an exhaustive testing of a program using all possible data values. Exhaustive testing is actually impossible. But for those software which are very critical and they involve life, then exhaustive testing may be taken up. 23rd, distinguish between static and dynamic analysis of a program. How are static and dynamic program analysis results useful? Let me tell you that static and dynamic varies in this, that in this static analysis, the program or the software is actually not run or executed. While in dynamic analysis, the program is actually executed. So static analysis tools assesses and compute various characteristic of a software product without executing it. We don't execute it here. While dynamic program analysis technique, it requires the program to execute or run and its actual behavior are recorded. Static analysis tools, they indicate whether adequate commenting has been done, whether the coding standards have been adhered to, followed or not. While this dynamic analysis tools, they are normally used to check whether the testing is satisfactory. What do you understand by automatic program analysis? Give a broad classification of different type of program analysis tools used during program development and what are the different types of information produced by each type of tool. So automated program analysis takes the source code or the executable code of a program as the input and it produces reports regarding several important parameters and characteristics of the program, such as its size, complexity, adequacy of the commenting, adherence to programming standards, etc. Some program analysis tools, they also produce reports regarding the adequacy of test cases. So we can classify all these tools into two broad categories of program analysis. One is static analysis tools and then is dynamic analysis tools. Design a black box test suite for a function that checks whether a character string is a palindrome or not, up to 25 character length. Palindrome means a string. If it is reversed, then it matches the previous or the actual string. So the reversed and the actual, they are same. The equivalence classes in black box testing, what we do, we do two things. First is the equivalence partitioning and then the boundary value analysis on these equivalent classes. So the equivalent classes that can be made is palindrome, whether it is a palindrome or not a palindrome, or a null string, and the string which contain more than 25 characters. So these equivalence class tests can be designed by choosing one representative test case for each of these equivalence classes. Then the boundary value can be checked by selecting a word with 25 characters and otherwise 26 characters on the boundary. 26. Design the black box test suite for a function that takes the name of a book as input and searches a file containing the name of the files available in the library and displays the details of the book. If the book is available in the library, otherwise displays the message book not available. For this, the equivalence classes would be book available, book not available, or invalid book name. And the equivalence classes or class test, this can be designed by choosing one representative test case for each of these equivalence classes. 27. Why is it important to properly document a software product? And what are the different ways of documenting a software product? See, the proper documentation, it will facilitate the maintenance, which takes around 40 to 60% effort of their development, after development. So there are two important types of documentation, that is internal documentation and external documentation. Why is it advantageous to detect errors during code and design reviews rather than detecting these error at the time of testing? Why it becomes advantageous? You know, it will cost less. Since testing detects failures, an additional debugging effort is needed to identify the error which is causing the failure. If you don't perform this detection of error during code and design, then it may be possible that you have to recode it altogether or to redesign it. And redesigning will take a lot of effort. These are the advantages. 29. What do you understand by the clean room strategy? What are its advantages? Clean room strategy. The clean room strategy, it relies heavily on the code walkthrough, code inspection, and formal verification. So the programmers, they are not allowed to test any of their code by executing the code other than doing some syntax testing using a compiler. This clean room will involve walkthrough, inspection, and formal verification. So this technique reportedly produces the documentation and the code that is more reliable and maintainable than other development methods relying heavily on the code execution based testing. So this clean room strategy is not on code execution basis, but on walkthrough, inspection, and formal verification. How can you compute the cyclomatic complexity of a program? How is cyclomatic complexity useful in program testing? Now, this is a very important question always asked. If you are provided a control flow graph G, the cyclomatic complexity we can easily compute with a control flow graph with E minus N plus 2 or the number of predicates plus 1. The N is the nodes of the control flow graph and E are the edges in the control flow graph. This cyclomatic complexity, it identifies an upper bound on the minimum number of independent paths. This also tells about the number of test cases needs to be generated. This helps to determine whether path testing is adequately done or not. Suppose in order to estimate the number of latent errors in a program, you seed it. This is seeding of errors with 100 errors of different kind. After testing the software using its full test set, you discover only 80 of the introduced errors. So you discover 15 other errors also, apart from what you have seeded. Estimate the number of latent errors in the software and what are the limitations of the error seeding method. So this is the formula here. Number of the latent error would be 100, which you seed. Number of errors which you seed. The errors which are other errors that are found divided by the numbers of error which you seeded and you found, that is your 80 minus the other error. So 80 minus 15, that will be 19 minus 15, 4. So the limitation of the error seeding method is that it implicitly assumes that the seeded errors, closely matches with the type and frequency of the existing errors, which is not always the case. So this is a limitation of error seeding. What is stress testing and why is stress testing applicable to only certain types of system? See, stress testing, it evaluates the performance when it is stressed for a short period of time. Means the load or the performance is checked after putting up all the pressure on the system. So stress testing is applicable only to those products which have an element of time or size in the specification of the system. 33 is, what do you understand by unit testing? Write the code for module that contains the function to implement the functionality to implement a bound stack of 100 integers. Assume that the stack functions supported are push and pop and is empty. This we have already covered in our theory session, but I'll tell you what unit testing is. Unit testing is actually the module testing. So once you complete the module, you perform a test on it so that the module which you have just made is being checked, and you can use the stubs and drivers here. 34 is, what do you understand by the term integration testing? Which types of defects are uncovered during integration testing? What are the different types of integration testing methods that can be used to carry out integration testing of a large software product? compare the demerits and demerits of these different integration testing strategies. So the basic crux of this, because we have already covered in detail, integration is testing between various module interfaces. So the interfacing, once you have checked these modules, means you have performed the testing on this module, that is called the unit testing. Now you want to see how these modules interface together. So interface defects among modules, these are detected during the integration testing. Discuss how would you perform system testing for a software that implements a queue of positive integral elements. Assume that the queue supports only the function insert an element, delete an element, and find an element. So I leave this also as an exercise for you, that how you can system test the queue version. 36 is, why is it advantageous to detect as many errors as possible during code review than during testing? First of all, it would cost less, because testing detects failures and additional debugging effort is required to identify the error causing the failure. So if it is done in code review and code inspection only, then the cost will be very less while you are testing and then going back to debug it. 37, what do you mean by side effects of a function call? Give examples of side effects. Why are obscure side effects undesirable? The side effects of a function call will include the modification of parameters which are passed by reference, because passing by reference will actually change the value of the original value, and also modification of global values and input-output operations. So these are the side effects of function calls. An obscure side effect is the one that is not obvious from a casual examination of the code. You cannot identify by just casual examination. That may be some obscure side effect. And obscure side effect will make it very difficult to understand a piece of code. What is regression testing? When is regression testing done? And why is regression testing necessary? And how is regression testing performed? What happens that regression testing is the practice of running an old test suite after each change to the system or after each bug fix to ensure that no new bug has been introduced due to the change or the bug fix. So while testing, you find some bug. Now you fix that bug, but you need to check, and you have to be very sure that introducing this new bug fixing has not introduced any other error. This is regression testing. However, if only a few statements are changed, then to retest entire test suite, it is not required. So this need not to be done. Only those test cases that test the functions that are likely to be affected by the change, that may be run. 39 is, do you agree with the statement system testing can be considered as a pure black box testing? Justify your answer. Yes, system testing is actually the black box testing. But system tests, they are designed based on the functional and non-functional requirement only, which are specified in your SRS document. Question number 40. What do you understand by Big Bang integration testing, and how is Big Bang integration testing performed? Describe situations where Big Bang integration testing is desirable. In Big Bang integration testing, what we do, all the modules are integrated in a single step. But normal integration testing, what we do, we combine one module with another, then we take the integration testing, then we add one more, then we add one more, or say we have some similar or likewise modules. So we combine two or three with these two. These are the stepwise integration with an integration plan. But Big Bang means combining all the modules which are existing. So Big Bang testing is desirable when we have a system which is very small, having only 3 to 4 modules. 41. What is the relationship between cyclomatic complexity and program comprehensibility? And can you justify why such apparent relationship exists, cyclomatic complexity and program comprehensibility? This program comprehensibility decreases as the cyclomatic complexity increases. Program comprehensibility means understanding the program, whether you are able to understand and manage it properly. But cyclomatic complexity, if you leave this word or ignore this word, it actually gives you the idea of complexity only. So if the program is complex or the software is complex, the product is complex, the comprehension will not be there. So the reason for this is the fact that cyclomatic complexity is an upper bound on the number of independent paths in the program. The programmers generally understand the working of a program by tracing the path from the outputs to the inputs. So when the cyclomatic complexity becomes high, the number of paths which are to be traced, they increase. And as a result, it becomes much more difficult to understand the program, obviously. When during the life cycle are the compliance to the coding standard and guidelines checked? So compliance to this coding standard and guideline, they are checked before the unit testing. After the code successfully compiles, not run, if the code is syntactically checked, because compilation will remove all the errors of syntax. And once it is compiled, then you can go for the coding standards and guideline checking. Identify the type of defects that you would be able to detect during the following code inspection and code walkthrough. Code inspection, code walkthrough. So in code inspection, compliance with the coding standards and presence of standard types of errors are checked. While in code walkthrough, during code walkthrough, the presence of logical error is checked, that is logarithmic or any logical errors, they are found. Okay. 47. Design the black box test suite for a function named quadratic solver. Quadratic solver accepts 3 floating points A, B, C, representing a quadratic equation of the form AX square plus BX plus C equal to 0. It computes and displays the solution. So the equivalence class for this quadratic solver would be real solution, imaginary solution, or no solution if A and B equal to 0. And also we can have coincident solution. So the equivalence class test can be designed by choosing one representative test case for each equivalence class. 48. Design the black box test suite for a function that accepts two pairs of floating point numbers representing two coordinate points. Each pair of coordinate points represents the center and the point on the circumference of the circle. The function prints whether the two circles are intersecting or is contained within the other or they are disjoint. It's quite simple. The equivalence classes for the given functions can be circle intersecting two points, circle intersecting at one point, disjoint circles, circle intersect at infinite number of points or coincident points, or invariant circle parameters. And you can choose the equivalent class test by choosing one representative test case for these equivalent classes. The 49 is design black box test case for a function called find intersection. This find intersection, it takes four numbers m1, c1, m2, c2, and its argument representing two straight lines, y is equal to m1x plus c1, y is equal to m2 x plus c2. So it determines the point of intersection of the two lines. Depending on the input values to the function, it displays any one of the following: single point of intersection or overlapping line, that is infinite number of intersection. Parallel line also, no point of intersection, invalid input values. So since these four conditions are given already, so the equivalence class can be made easily for a given function, like single point of intersection, overlapping lines, parallel lines, invalid input values. And we can easily have equivalence class tests that can be designed by choosing one representative case for each equivalence class. Design black box test suite for the following. The program accepts two pair of coordinates x1, y1, x2, y2, x3, y3, x4, y4. The first two points, these two, it represents the lower left and the upper right corner of the first rectangle. The second represents the lower left and the upper right points of the second rectangle. So it is assumed that the length and the width of the rectangle are parallel to each other, to the x and y axis. The program computes the point of intersection of two rectangles and prints their point of intersection. So the equivalence classes would be like this: disjoint rectangles, intersecting rectangles, rectangles with one side overlapping, rectangles touching at one point, coincident rectangles, rectangles with two side overlapping. So the equivalence classes test that can be easily designed by choosing one representative case of each of these equivalence classes. Design black box test suite for a program that accepts up to 10 simultaneous linear equations in up to 10 independent variables and displays the solution. So we can have unique solution, infinite solution, no solution, too many variables, or invalid equation, for example, y equal to 0. And we can just choose test cases from every equivalence classes here. 52. Design a black box test suite for following library automation software. The library automation software accepts a string representing the name of the book. It checks the library catalog and displays whether the book is listed in the catalog or not. So if the book is listed in the catalog, it displays the number of copies that are currently available in the racks and the copies issued out. And the equivalence classes would be book available, book not available, and book issued out. 53. Design the black box suite for a program that accepts two strings and checks if a first string is a substring of second string, and it displays the number of times the first string occurs in the second string. The equivalence classes could be no match, identical string, or proper substring. 54. Design black box suite for a program that accepts a pair of points defining a straight line and another point and a floating number defined in the center of a circle and its radius. It computes their points of intersection and prints them. So it would be intersection at one point, intersecting at two points, no point of intersection, and invalid input. Then we will take this question 57, because 55, 56, and 57 are the questions which we have already seen of this type. So identify the type of information that should be presented in the test summary report. The test summary report will normally cover each subsystem and represent a summary of tests which have been applied to the system. So it will specify how many tests have been applied to a system, how many tests have been successful, how many have been unsuccessful, and the degree to which they have been unsuccessful. For example, whether a test was an outright failure or whether some of the expected results of the test were actually observed. Right? I hope you will work on 55, 56, and 58 by yourself. So thank you so much. This was Coding and Testing of the Dr. Rajiv Mal's book on software engineering.